Okay, I have, well, we're going to get started anyway without these guys. Oh, there's Kristen. Yay, we were just about to get started. Because I have a kind of long video to show you guys.
Why'd you listen to my phone?
Let's get going. And so, is there any connection between the Princess Bride and Christianity? Let's think. The Holy Bible.
Yeah, has it they got, got married.
They, has it got any sports in it? Are you
no.
kidding? Fencing, fighting, torture, revenge, giants,
oh, yes.
monsters, chases, escapes, true love, and miracles. I'm telling you, it's very, there's a lot of things to look at here. So this is the guy who wrote it. He is, he's Jewish. There are a lot of Jewish people in this movie, and I mean a lot, including the director. So a lot of the Judeo-Christian ideas really shine through. This guy wrote, there were only two things that he said he was proud of writing, Princess Bride and Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. But he did get an Academy Award also for writing All the President's Men.
It's not about my hair, it's like this.
So can you guess, wow, your hair really needs some brushing.
Yeah, she got paint in the deck.
Oh, that's right, I saw. Did you use your hair to paint the deck?
No.
She used every orifice of her being.
It's just everywhere paint.
I said my sister and I said I was a human washcloth.
Well, I saw a picture and you did look like a human washcloth, and you probably shouldn't use your hair as a paintbrush. I'm just saying. So, the Princess Bride story. Oh, there's Emily. The Princess Bride story began when his two daughters asked him when he was going on a business trip. He felt bad because he had to go, and he said, I'll write you a story while I'm gone. What should I write about? And one of his daughters said a princess, and the other daughter said a bride. And so that's how you got the movie, The Princess Bride. And like I said, this is one of only two. He's written a lot of things, but this is one of only two things he's proud
that's
of.
So sweet.
Isn't that sweet?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's That's a secret to this book, because it was written for his two daughters, and he calls it an adapted version by Simon Morgenstern, and it turns out that's a pseudonym that William Goldman used, and he used it as a narrative device to add another layer to the novel. So he says it's like the grandfather is reading him this favorite book. But actually, he wrote the favorite book, too.
Oh, so that's the guy in the movie?
Yeah, the guy in the movie. No, that's Peter Falk, who's also Jewish. But if you read the book, which I really commend to you, because it's very sweet and it's very satirical, and there's lots of layers of comedy in it. But he says, I'm rewriting this great fairy tale from the country of Florin, but actually he wrote the fairy tale, too. For his daughters. And he told it to him like the grandpa tells it to the Fred Savage kid, who is also Jewish, in the movie. So I was gonna do a review for you guys, but I just remembered this meme. Let me explain. No, it's too much. Let me sum up. So there are parts of this review that are not accurate, but it's the movie from the perspective of two kids, and I think you're gonna like this. Let me know if you can't hear it.
Hey everybody, I'm Kelly.
I'm Maddie.
And I'm Rylan.
And this is the story of
The Princess Bride.
The Haunted Village.
Princess Buttercup is pretty, but really bossy.
Be my horse.
As you wish.
Do the dishes. You do that. How about you punch your butt?
As you wish.
The boy's going for Johnny. She says, I don't want you to get hurt or be killed.
Don't worry.
Yeah, don't worry. And these three guys, there's a strong guy, a not strong guy, and a little guy. The big guy takes her by her head.
The little guy says, hey, Bob. Hey, Gerald. Yeah, we're confused with everyone's name. And then they just bring her on the ship. The strong guy keeps rhyming. Toad Road, Thunder
Wonder. Thunder Wonder.
Wait. Ship
Whip.
Pit.
No, that does not rhyme.
Sip Pit?
No, that does not
rhyme. Sip Whip. She hears a sound and the guy's like, those are the swinking eels.
No, they are shrieking eels, like,
okay, whatever.
They see an introduced dressed in black. They climb up this rope up to a mountain, and they say, hurry, hurry, he's catching up. And then the little person says, inseatable.
Insensitable.
Sensitable.
I should know how to say that because I'm a second grader. And he's like, you're the guy who killed my father.
Because he had six fingers. And he says, my father had six fingers.
And then they have a little picnic.
Then your dude, he's like, which one do you think is poison?
And he's like,
I'm dead.
They come to a hill. Then she throws him down.
And he says, I regret nothing!
And then she says, ha, I should fall too.
Ah, my face! Ah, my booty!
You're cray cray.
But I love you.
Princess Bride.
Yes, and then the grandpa was reading, he said, does it have to be back to the kissing part?
And then this big groundhog catches a boy. It was biting the sand.
I'm pretty sure they're red.
Groundhog.
She said, I have never seen a grown rat.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay, let's just keep going. And then the girl dropped him off at this wizard's house.
He said, I'm a magical man. I mean, guy. Anyway, I'm magical.
The wizard's wife, she's like, hey, I'm your wife!
Oh, that's an ugly face! Ugh. You're sick, then eat this poop nugget.
Then, Buttercup is in a castle. Prince Humperdinck. I'm not marrying that guy. I don't want to. And then Prince Humperdinck, he says,
because I have stinky farts,
because I love farting. The wizard's wife, she's like, boo! She wants the other man, boo!
I think she wants to marry the other guy, because he does a lot of chores for he's a nice guy, I guess.
Ronald, he like keeps banging the door and he's like, can you please help me? He's like, here, I'll help you. Look out! Prince Humperdinck and the guys want to have a fight to see who gets the princess.
They say, my name is Prepare to Die. My father had six fingers.
They're like fighting. The guy kills Princess Prince Humperdinck.
Princess Humperdinck. And he's like, oh man! And then they kiss. Does it have to be back to the kissing part? Inconceivable.
So that inconceivable. I should that be inconceivable.
That was not accurate. It was not happening.
I know it was not.
My father had six fingers. No.
Well, that was why I wanted to ask you the question, how much do you know? Because those kids really did not know a lot about the Princess Bride, but they got it.
They got the gist of it.
They got the gist of it. It makes me cry laughing. So why don't we do a game?
Yay!
Yeah, let's see if you guys know about the Princess Bride. So we are going to do an As You Wish. Oh, and I don't have a note. Who's going to keep score for me?
Hey.
All right. You're good. You know what, guys? You're going to have to go on the honor system. Okay? And you're going to have to keep count on your fingers of who gets the most. Okay? So we'll shout out the answer, but if you've got the, if you just keep count, and on the honor system, I'll ask you how many you got.
Wait! I have my phone. I can do it on text.
No, okay.
Honor system.
But I'm okay. Bad at remembering everything.
So here we are. It's a marriage of the minds, people. If you like it, you should have put a wing on it. Let's. You ready for the questions?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's go. What is the name of the hilarious character played in the movie by Billy Crystal?
Can we shout it out or keep track?
Okay, what? You can shout it out if you want.
I'll let kids go first.
All right, who do you think it is? Which of these?
Fantastic Fred.
All right. Any other guesses?
What is that?
C is right. Miracle Max.
It looks like a
who
cracker.
Likes a mutton and lettuce and tomato sandwich where the mutton is extra lean. Okay, which of these actresses did not audition for the role of Buttercup?
I don't know.
I pay attention to actors. I pay attention to the movie.
You know, actors.
D?
Not B.
Not B, because she got it. Any guesses? I'm seeing a guess for number.
Julia Roberts?
Yes. Who got that?
Chrissy.
All right. Julia Roberts did not audition. Okay. How many times throughout the film does Inigo Montoya say his signature line?
Oh, boy.
And bonus points for whoever can say it.
What's his name?
My
name is Neil Montoya. You killed my father, prepared to die.
Yes, it is B. And you got the entire phrase.
Yes.
Excellent.
How many? Wait, one extra point?
Yeah, you get an extra point because you said, hello, my name is Inigo Montoya. You killed my father. Prepare to die. All right, this is really important, people. What does R-O-U-S stand for?
Come on.
D.
Take out it.
D.
Rodents.
Yay! All right, excellent, William. All right. So, what's the name of the character we mentioned this earlier, played by Andre the Giant, and what is his hobby?
Frederick Rhyming.
Isaac.
Frederick.
Hey. Frederick. You remember in the video we just saw, they called him Bob. They can't remember his name.
It's D, I think.
It is D, you think. You were close. It's Fezzik. And it's rhyming. And where did you find him? Unemployed in Greenland.
That was funny.
Okay. The kid, Fred Savage, the grandson. What's the video game he's playing?
When the grandpa home run?
Battle up.
I think it's B.
I think it's D.
Who said D?
Me, Emily.
Emily, you win, Emily. You got a point, Emily. You are correct.
Hardball.
And that was a hardball. All right, Vizzini. The name of the villain who I am, if you take the BuzzFeed quiz, which Princess Bride character are you, is also the name of a town located where?
In Australia.
In Italy.
In Italy?
I don't pay attention to those
eagles. Trick question.
Sicily.
So Italy, Sicily is in Italy, right?
Oh, yeah, Sicily is in Italy, so Italy, yeah.
Italy, so I will pick either A or D, but Sicily is the correct answer because Sicily is a part of Italy.
Okay.
But we'll take either. Okay, who plays Count Tyrone Rugen, the six-fingered man?
Christopher Guest.
Who said that?
Me.
All right, good job, Christopher Guest. Okay, William, I'm going to guess that you're going to get this right. What is Wesley's secret identity? What's his pirate name?
Yes,
he is.
See? Dead Pirate Roberts.
The Dread Pirate Roberts. Yes.
I knew that. I did not accidentally read it wrong. What?
Didn't accidentally do the wrong one? Okay, good. All right, here's a question for you. This is like the SAT of Princess Bride. Just like the grandfather said, this story really does have everything. Which of the below are one
unicorns.
Of the
other? Unicorns.
All right, yes, you are correct. There are no unicorns. And that, my friends, is the only way that you could make this more perfect is to add a unicorn. Otherwise, it's a perfect movie. Okay. Now your biology lesson here. What recessive trait is present in the man who tortures Wesley?
What the heck is albinism?
Six fingers on one hand.
The man who guess what? Six fingers on one hand is actually not a recessive trait. It is a dominant trait. It is a rare dominant trait. So if you are born with six fingers on your hand, it is very likely that you will have a child with six fingers on your hand. There's your biology lesson. You said B?
I didn't say B. I said, what the heck is albinism?
You said, what the heck is albinism?
Yes. Yeah.
I wish I had a picture to show you. It's when you lack melanin in your skin and you're very pale. So if you've seen people who have...
Oh, yeah. He's very pale.
He's very pale. And they call him the albino.
Sometimes my husband's mistaken for that.
Ah, okay. So now we're to the point in the game where we're blaming people. My husband told me to say that. Okay. So but remember, because this is really important to Uncle Dan, know that six fingers on one hand, polydactylism, is a dominant trait and not rare. He just said that for him. Okay, wait. I was gonna say who's got what's the count?
I only have 1 point. have 7.
I have 6.
6, okay.
I have 5.
Does anyone else have 7? 7. So we don't need the tiebreaker question, but I think we're going to do it anyway.
Yay!
What is Buttercup not called in her Queen of Coronation?
Refuse.
The B.
But B and D are the exact same answer.
Refuge.
Refuge.
There's 2 refuges.
I know, because I'm helping you out.
Refuse.
No.
Slime and muck.
Slime.
Muck. No. She was called
yes.
Muck.
I should agree with C.
She was called muck. Oh.
She does say muck. You are right. This is a trick question. She is that's what she is, the queen of refuse, a bowdo, if you want, the queen of slime, the queen of filth, the queen of putrescence. Boo, boo, boo. So you're singing along with me. Slime, filth, muck. But she doesn't call her the queen of muck. So there. All right. So who got 7? Say your name.
Megan.
Wait. Was it Megan?
Yeah.
And Kristen? All right, so there was a tie. All right. So let's go over some of the major characters, because some of these major characters have Bible lessons for us today. So, and we're going to do better than those kids who made that video. So we've got Princess Buttercup. And
we have Wesley.
In the book, she loves Wesley and her horse. Does anybody know what her horse's name is?
No.
It's Horse.
Horse.
Yeah.
Really?
So in the book, her horse's name is Horse and the farm boy's name is Farm Boy. So she's not terribly good at naming things. Okay, and she in the book, she's feisty and tomboyish, and it's only when she realizes that she loves Wesley that she starts brushing her hair. So, Chrissy, when you were brushing your hair, I was like, we've got a future Buttercup here. So, Wesley leaves the farm because he realizes that finally Princess Buttercup loves him, and he's going to go seek his fortune, and then he becomes the Dread Pirate Roberts. Okay, so these 3 guys, what are their names?
Inigo.
Inigo. Inigo.
That is his name.
Inigo Montoya, the sword fighting expert, is the guy on his left, right?
Exini.
Vizini, yes. The smuggler, Sicilian, and
Fezzik.
Fezzik, yes.
Wait, what does she say all the time? Vizini?
Inconceivable.
Inconceivable.
Wait, can you say it?
Inconceivable.
I say inconceivable
times a day.
Inconceivable.
It was funny because he didn't, because he's like, I don't think he knows what that means.
You keep using that word. I do not think it means what you think it means. Okay, so these 2 guys, who are these 2 guys?
The Jokey Prince and the Six-Fingered Man.
The Dorky Prince, Prince Humperdinck.
The Jokey.
And he is rather ridiculous and self-absorbed. And then Count Rugen is the evil six-fingered man. He loves to torture people, and he killed Inigo Montoya's father. All right, what about these 2? Oops. I got you. I put their names up. Sorry. So Miracle Max, he was the king's leading miracle man, but Humperdinck fired him. Humperdinck fired him. And then the other thing I say about once a day is a line from Valerie. I'm not a witch, I'm your wife. And I say that at least once a day. Somebody in my house. And she's not a witch. But all miracle men have to have their own witches, so she's a stand-in witch for the miracle man. And actually, this movie came out in 1987 when Uncle Dan and I got married, and I pretty much thought that we would be like the couple on the top. But it turns out we're more like the couple on the bottom. We're a lot more like Miracle Max and Valerie.
Liar!
I'm not listening. Okay, so who wants to read this scripture for me? Go ahead, Megan. Hello.
Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers who struck him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead.
So how is this a lesson from Miracle Max, you might ask? Miracle Max would tell you this guy is mostly dead. There's a difference between mostly dead and all dead. If he's mostly dead, he's slightly alive. If he's all dead, there's only one thing you can do, which is go through his clothes and look for loose change.
That was funny.
So one of the important lessons we have to take away from Miracle Max is to tell the difference between someone who is mostly dead and all dead. So let's go to Vizzini for a second. He didn't die. William, can you read the meme?
Yes, you're not gonna do it.
He didn't die.
Inconceivable.
Inconceivable.
The sidewalk.
And that's kind of the I found a scripture about Jesus because it really sort of bothered Satan that that Jesus didn't die. So who wants to read this scripture? Megan, you gonna go for it?
Yeah.
All right.
He disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him.
He didn't die. Jesus didn't die. Inconceivable. All right, here's another lesson from Vizzini. Can someone read that for me?
I will get involved in a land war in Asia.
Yes. This is a very important lesson. What's another important lesson from Vizzini?
Don't overuse the word inconceivable.
That's a good one, too. Never go up against a Sicilian.
Sicilian.
Death is on the line. Okay, so how about Inigo Montoya? Let's do some lessons from Inigo Montoya. Hello, my name is Inigo Montoya. Okay, so Inigo Montoya doesn't have any Bible lessons, but he does have some great networking lessons. So first, when you meet someone, it's nice to give them a polite introduction. Hello. My name is a polite greeting. Hello. That's a polite greeting, right? Tell them your name. Hello. My name is Inigo Montoya. Give them a relevant personal link. Hello. My name is Inigo Montoya. You killed my father. And then manage their expectations.
Prepare to die.
Remember, when you're meeting somebody new, use the Inigo Montoya method for social networking. Give them a polite greeting, tell them your name, identify some relevant personal link with them, and then manage their expectations.
What if I used just what Inigo Montoya did?
Yeah, you really should.
And then see if anybody gets it.
Right, you really should, you know. Or if someone is, if you find someone bullying someone in school, you might go up and say, hello, my name is Megan. You bullied my friend. Prepare to die.
And then get suspended.
you'll give my father, which actually Luke's got, William, are you like having this moment? Yeah. Luke Skywalker has the same Inigo Montoya moment, except that it turns out Darth Vader is his father. Spoiler alert. So most of the Christian lessons, though, come from Wesley, who is as you wish. And isn't he cute with his eyes that look like the sea after a storm? Let's watch a clip from the movie. It's a kissing clip.
Boo. Buttercup, as much pleasure as ordering Wesley around.
Farm boy, polish my horse's saddle. I want to see my face shining in it by morning.
Sandwich.
As you wish, was all he ever said.
Farm boy, fill these with water. Please.
As you wish.
That day, she was amazed to discover that when he was saying, as you wish, what he meant was, I love you. And even more amazing was the day she realized she truly loved him back.
Come on. Fetch me that picture.
She could totally reach that picture, guys. She I'm gonna say. There, he's only like an inch taller than her. If that. Oh, kissing part. Is it over? Okay, good. I couldn't watch the kissing part. Now I can't even get off this slide. So, the next time that you love someone and they ask you to do something for them, try answering as you wish. And see if that, you know, when your mom says clean your room and you go to do it and you say as you wish, what you're really saying is, I love you. And this is a really important thing that Jesus told us. And this is a scripture from John 14:15. Who wants to read this?
If you love me, obey my commandments.
If you love me, obey my commands. And Jesus says, now Jesus isn't being bossy, right? He's saying, if you really love me, you're going to obey my commands. Why do you guys think that is?
Because you want to please them?
Yeah, we want wisdom, right? We want, Jesus created us, and he has our best interests.
Just you, Baba!
Whoa. And wait, somebody's not saying as you wish right there. So what's really interesting is when we love God, we want to obey his commands because we know that he gave them to us out of love for us. So we obey the command. Let's take one that I think so far we've all obeyed, which is thou shalt not kill. I'm going to guess that everybody here has not murdered someone. Maybe in their mind, but not.
Yes.
We obey that, yes. because God told us to, and that's in our heart, and we know that it's the right thing to do. And so one of the really interesting things at Ginger and Cajun's school is their old school Holy Comforter was a prayer that they would do that would end with, help us to find our freedom in doing your will. And it may seem like Wesley is a slave, right, to Buttercup, but he's really not. He could have left at any time, but he because he loved her, he obeyed her commands. And that's one of the things that's really important for us to remember, is that because we love God, or when we love God, we want to obey his command.
I have two questions about it.
Who's drawing on Wesley? Okay, go ahead, Megan, you have two questions.
One, where are Buttercup's parents in all this? And two, does Wesley get paid?
So these are two very good questions. And to find the answers, you have to read the book, which I reread yesterday. And Buttercup's parents are in the house, and you don't see them in the movie. And that's probably because Rob Reiner, the director, didn't want to pay two more actors. But Buttercup's parents, I love whoever's figured out how to annotate this, and I'm going to guess it's either William or somebody. I can bust it. Buttercup's parents are dairy farmers, and how Count Rugen...
Me.
Oh, it's not you. Is it Emily?
It's me. It's Chrissy.
It's Chrissy. You're the one annotating. William, I'm sorry I blamed you. So, okay, let's
He's skip doing some of it.
Megan's question, though, which is how, where are her parents? Her parents are dairy farmers, and Count Rugen first comes to their farm because he wants to learn how to have good dairy cows. And yes, Wesley does get paid, but not much, because there's not a lot of money in being a farm boy. If you really want to become wealthy, I would suggest that farm boy is not the career for you. Okay.
Can you stop putting point marks?
Yep, somebody stop point, because this is a really funny meme. Don't ruin my meme. Take those off. I don't know how to clear them. Because what you need to understand is that Boba Fett in Star Wars really loves Darth Vader. And how do we know this? Because Darth Vader says, don't harm him, and Boba Fett says, as you wish. Really saying, I love you.
You can see Steven's face right now.
And look at Billy Dee Williams. He's like, how are you going to respond to that love, man? Lando Bizdek, his brother just told you that he loves you. How are you going to respond to that? It better be, I love you back. Okay. Let's go on to another lesson from the Dread Pirate Roberts. Look at those eyes. Oh. Let's play this one.
You mock my pain.
Life is pain, Highness. Anyone who says differently is selling something.
Oh, good point, right?
Life Very good point.
Is pain. Anyone who says otherwise is selling something. And who's going to read the scripture for me?
Me.
Go for it.
I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world.
Thank you, Emily. That was perfect. So Jesus says we are going to have trouble. We're going to have pain. Life is going to stink sometimes. And some people sign up for Christianity because they think it's going to solve all their problems. And I'm here to tell you, it doesn't stop the problems from coming. The promise that God gives us is that he's going to give us peace. And in the end, he has overcome the world. So I love that quote because it's very, very realistic. Oh, and one more lesson from Wesley about love. Wesley has this great line in The Princess Bride, which is, death cannot stop true love. All it can do is delay it for a while. And so Wesley is sort of like a Christ figure, right? He comes back because of his true love for Buttercup. So if Wesley is a Christ figure in the movie, then what's Buttercup? I'm just going to skip ahead and give you the answer. Buttercup is the church. Buttercup is us. So Buttercup, do you ever think, like, why does Wesley love her? She's kind of sassy and she bosses him around. And yeah, she's not perfect. And then when he goes away, she agrees to marry Prince Humperdinck, not out of love, but just because she's kind of bored. She's not the most faithful person in terms of waiting around, but you understand her reasoning more if you read the book. And I do think you should read the book. But in the Bible, they talk about Jesus being the groomsman and the church. That's us. The church isn't a building. Jesus isn't marrying a building. He's marrying the people in the building. The church is the people who believe in him. We're known as the bride of Christ. So Buttercup is like us. She's not perfect. She figures things out far too late, like when she pushes him down the hill and then only then realizes that it's her one true love. But he will do anything. Jesus would do anything for us, and he will always come to save us, like Wesley says. So who wants to read this scripture?
Me.
Go for it.
Let us rejoice and exult and give him the glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready.
So remember when I talked about, thank you, by the way, it's true love. remember I told you in the book, Buttercup is kind of like a tomboy and she's all covered in dirt. And then when she finally realizes that Wesley's her one true love, she learns how to brush her hair and she actually takes a shower for the first time in her life. She makes herself ready. And it says in the book, it's kind of funny. It says, it was a lot of effort to get herself ready, but he was worth it. So I would say that now that we know that we are the bride of Christ, that it's a lot of effort to get ready, right? It's a lot of effort to love people. It's a lot of effort, especially when they're not lovable. It's a lot of effort to be the best person that we can be, but it's worth it in the end. So I just want to encourage you guys with that this week. I didn't have any other real lessons from this movie, but I'm wondering if you guys have some lessons. Megan?
Boy, isn't Buttercup basically telling us to give up our personal hygiene just until we find love?
Well, that's a good question. In the book, she's not saying that. It was that she just didn't care about that aspect of herself because she was very self-absorbed. So her parents, you know, her parents let her run around with rats in her hair and being all dirty.
Ew.
Which is not really good parenting, and maybe that's another reason why they left them out of the movie, aside from not wanting to pay some extras. But when she decided that she had someone to love, she decided to take care of herself better, not for herself, but for them. And I think that's one of the aspects of love, like we were talking about when you're cleaning your room. And I know that each one of you says, as you wish, when you're asked to do something, you know, like, Emily, set the table. And I know that you say to your dad, as you wish, and you never argue back. Or they say, William, do your homework. And you say, as you wish, which I know you do. Then what you're really doing is becoming better because you know that they have your best interests at heart and they want you to be a better person, and that it's going to help you to learn things like setting the table or cleaning your room or doing your homework. Does that make sense? But she was kind of stinky before she fell in love with Wesley. And I will tell you this, you don't have to have a Prince Charming to take a shower once in a while. It's probably good practice to do it, you know, maybe on a regular basis, whether or not you have a Prince Charming or a princess. So I wanted to know, I wanted to get a promise from you guys that you are going to go take either the BuzzFeed quiz or the Zimbio quiz and figure out which Princess Bride character you are, because it would be really fun, and maybe you can share it with us. You can put it in the comments on my Facebook.
So that's our homework?
I think that's your homework for the week. Megan, what do you think you're going to guess you are?
I don't know.
You had your hand raised, so I thought you knew.
No, I don't know what I was saying.
And Emily, what do you think you're going to get?
I don't know.
Good question, huh? Kristen, what do you think you're going to get?
You know, I don't know. Maybe right. Mad Max.
Maybe Mad Max. I think that's good. William, what do you think you're going to get? He doesn't know either. Huh? He doesn't know. And did we lose Chrissy? I guess we
yeah.
lost her.
We lost she Chrissy. Left.
All right, she left. Okay. Well, any prayer requests for this week? They'll do this the same old, and then, okay, let's pray, and then we can decide what we're going to do next week.
I thought we were doing Avengers, like the Marvel.
Oh, that's right, we are. We're still good with Avengers?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think I'm really excited about that. In fact, they started working on it this week, so... all right, well, let's pray. And God, thank you for this time together, and thank you for the world's most perfect movie. We pray that you will be with all of our friends and family this week, that you will give us a sense of peace, and that you will remind us when we're asked to do something to show love and to say as you wish to the people in our lives who ask us to do things. And we pray that you would continue to teach us lessons from Princess Bride. And we also pray that this week none of us gets involved in a land war in Asia. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.